stories held in the Old Testament. Jonah, as a prophet of the Lord Jesus Christ, receives a divine commission to go preach at a place that he, quite frankly, does not want to go preach at. The Bible tells us that of all places on earth for God to assign and send his prophet to go, the word comes to Jonah to go and preach in the city of Nineveh. Nineveh, a wicked city. Nineveh, a place of iniquity and harlotry. Nineveh, the Assyrian capital, the place where Israel's enemies reside. And yet the commission comes to Jonah that he would go to this unpopular and unpleasant place called Nineveh. Jonah decides that he will take command of his ministry and ignore the calling and commissioning of God and not go to Nineveh to preach. But according to the word of God, he heads into the opposite direction, down to a place called Joppa. And when he arrives at Joppa, it is indeed his intent to board a boat headed for Tarshish. And while at Tarshish, Jonah would not do the will of God, but would do the exact opposite of that which God has commanded him to do. As we immerse ourselves into the waters of the narrative of Jonah, allow me to suggest that it was just another day at the docks of Joppa. As boats were coming to and fro to carry cargo and passengers to their desired destinations. And I can see on that particular day at the port of Joppa, those passengers boarding a boat for what they thought would be an ordinary voyage, a regular journey to their destination, Tarshish. If you would allow me to suggest, as we look at the word of God, that day at the docks of Joppa, the sun was positioned in its normal place in the sky, providing the captain of the ship clearance to let him know that it would be a smooth ride on the waters. I can see the greeters standing on the docks of Joppa, letting the passengers on board to the boat for what they thought would be just an easy cruise down the waters, eventually arriving at their destination, Tarshish. Little did they know that on this day there was a poisonous passenger getting on board. Little did they know that on this day there was a dastardly passenger who was boarding this ship headed for Tarshish. And although it seemed like it would be a smooth ride on the waters, little did they know that as they set sail from the docks of Joppa, that there was a storm that would yet find them on the waters. Allow me to suggest that this storm was what I call Hurricane Jonah. Yes, because as Jonah boarded that boat, I would suggest that even though Jonah thought that he could run away from the presence of God, and even though Jonah thought that he could ignore the commissioning of God, despite the fact that Jonah thought his wisdom and wittiness was of such that he could outsmart God, Jonah did not know that God was hot on his trail. And that it did not matter where he tried to run away from the will of God, Jonah is about to learn this lesson the hard way, that there is no place that you can run from the presence and the will of God. It was the psalmist who posed that question in the 139th Psalm. Where can I flee from the presence of God? If I go into the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. Jonah makes a mistaken calculation on this day that he can outrun the presence of God. As Jonah boards this ship, I can see Jonah relaxing. I can see Jonah kicking back. He didn't want to go to Nineveh to preach. He did not want to follow the word of God. And I can see Jonah wiping his brow, saying, I'm not going to Nineveh to preach. I'm not going to Assyria, but I'm just going to enjoy this cruise. I'm going to sit on the observation deck, and I'm going to allow view the sun kissing the waters of the sea. I'm going to take in the fresh air of this voyage. Can't you see Jonah as he's kicking back, enjoying his trip to Tarshish? But the Bible says, if you would, allow me to use the paintbrush of my imagination. The Bible says that the sun was dim, and that the puffy and pillow-like clouds that decorated the blue and the waves of heaven became filled with a providential precipitation, and that Jonah's view on the observation deck was disrupted by what I'll call some divine inclement weather. And all of a sudden, Jonah found himself transitioned from sitting on the deck of his cruise to now in the bottom of the ship, caught up in the middle of a storm. My brothers and sisters, can I sardonically suggest to you that God knows how to change the scenery of your life? Just when you think you're getting away with something, and just when it seems like you've escaped from God, and it seems like you've got the thing working in your favor, God knows how to change the scenery in your life. God can take the clear skies of prosperity and tint them with the darkness of disturbance. God knows how to take the plush, pillowy clouds of blessing and fill them with the precipitation of problems. Anybody can testify that God can change the weather in your life, and God can change the scenery in your life. God can take you from a place where you thought you had got away from it and nobody knew about it, to a place where you come face to face with the reality that you cannot run away from God. I know you don't want to say amen here to that tonight, because you don't want us to believe that you've ever run away from the will of God. You want us to believe that you don't have any Jonah in your system tonight. That everything God told you to do, you said, yes, Lord. And everywhere God told you to go, you said, God, I'm on my way. No, I think I can agree. I can get a witness in this house tonight that we all have some Jonah in our system. We all have a little bit of Jonah in our attitudes. And just the time when you feel like you've gotten away with that thing, God has a way of showing up to let you know that I'm too high for you to go over me. I wish I had a witness in this house. I'm too deep for you to go under me. I'm too wide for you to go around me. You can run, but you can't hide, because there's nowhere that you can run that I can't find you. There's no place that your money can buy you that I don't already own. That you can run, but you can't hide for too long. Jonah finds himself caught up in a storm. And can we just be honest with ourselves and with the text tonight? Jonah doesn't have anybody to blame for this situation but himself. Isn't that a hard reality to face in life? But Pastor, you know what I've discovered? That we always like to blame a third party for why we're going through what we're going through. We always like to be able to say it's her fault or it's his fault. But Jonah couldn't even blame anybody else for this dilemma. Jonah had to look at himself in the mirror and say, I'm the reason why I'm going through what I'm going through. I tell the people at the church that I pastor, so many Christians today live with that Flip Wilson theology. Y'all know who Flip Wilson is, huh? I'm 30 years old. If I know who Flip Wilson is, I know you ought to know who Flip Wilson is, huh? What is Flip Wilson's favorite line? The devil made me do it, huh? Amen. We always like to talk about what the devil made us do. But can I just get somebody here who can just be honest to say, yes, I got Jonah in me, and the devil ain't made me do what I was doing. I knew what I was doing. I planned it out. I thought about what I was doing. I put images. Now stop looking at me like you ain't ever planned out some of your mess. Some of you here, you can testify, just like Jonah, I made up my mind that I wasn't going to do what God told me to do. And it didn't matter if the preacher told me different or if my friends told me different. I was a premeditated sinner. I premeditated the fact that I would not do what God has called me to do. And now, in this first chapter of Jonah, he's caught up in the middle of a storm. Everybody on the boat is caught up in a storm. I really don't want to preach the whole first chapter of Jonah, but let me just say right here, you got to be careful who you let on your boat. Come on here and talk to me tonight. You got to be careful who you let on your boat. Can I tell you something tonight? You can fool around here and connect yourself with a Jonah and discover that you were suffering in a storm that you ain't got nothing to do with. That you are only the collateral damage because you connected with the wrong person and you allowed the wrong person to be a passenger on your boat. Anybody can testify you had to learn that lesson the hard way? Anybody been burnt by some Jonas that you let in your life? They had mess headed for them. They had problems headed for them. But you fooled around there and connected with a Jonah personality. And now their mess has become your mess. Their problems have become your problems. Their debt has become your debt. Somebody wants to knock their head off. Somebody wants to knock your head off. Because if you let the wrong person on your boat, you can find yourself caught up in a storm that you didn't have anything to do with. The passengers on this boat, they say, something's wrong here. This is a storm the likes of which we've never seen before. And I see Jonah convicted and quiet in the corner because he knows that he's the cause of the storm. Everybody's trying to figure out what's wrong. Why is the ship taking on water? Can't you see Jonah? Of the ship trying his best to navigate the boat through the waters and winds of the storm. And don't you see Jonah sitting over in the corner with his finger over his mouth? Doesn't want anybody to know that he is the cause of the... I see the deckhands trying to adjust the sail so that the boat can survive the storm. And look at little old Jonah sitting in the corner of the boat, realizing that he's the cause of the storm. I see the frantic and panicking passengers as they're moving to and fro, trying to keep themselves from falling overboard. And little old quiet Jonah is sitting in the corner of the boat with his finger over his mouth, knowing that he's the cause of the storm. Don't you
leaves of that ship. And little Jonah is sitting over in the corner because he doesn't want anybody to know that he's the cause of the storm. And finally, Jonah has the courage to step up and say, wait a minute, y'all. I wish I had a witness in this. I'll tell you why the winds are blowing. I can tell you why the waves are breaking. I can tell you why the storm clouds have shown up. I'm the reason for the storm. I'm the cause of this situation. I'm the reason why the storm is assailing this boat. And the Bible says that after they cast lots and begin to do a number of things, finally Jonah has enough courage to say, there's only one way that this storm is going. There's only one way for you to get the winds to stop blowing. There's only one way for you to get the waves to stop breaking against the boat. You've got to take me and throw me overboard. Can I press pause in the sermon right now and help somebody? You see, when you get Jonah on your boat, you got to learn how to throw some folk overboard. I wish I had a witness in here. You got to learn how to throw some stuff overboard in your life. Fact of the matter is that if you allow it to remain on your boat, you and the boat going to go under. But I think I got a witness in here that if it comes down to a decision between me and my boat and you, I can take you and yourself and throw you overboard. Jonah, the cause for the storm. Jonah, the cause of the problem has now been thrown overboard. Storm has ended for the passengers, but Jonah's hell has just started. Can't you see Jonah sinking in the waters? Sinking in those waves. Jonah should have rightfully drowned if it weren't for the fact that verse 17 tells us that even though he was running away from God, even though he thought he outsmarted God, even though he felt like God couldn't locate him on his sovereign GPS system, verse 17 tells us God was already prepared for the occasion. For verse 17 tells us that as Jonah is sinking in the waters, after Jonah has been thrown overboard, the Bible tells us that God had prepared a fish. And that the great fish that God has prepared swallowed Jonah up. Now I gotta be honest with you right here. Verse 17 is the part of Jonah that scholars have a problem with. Verse 17 is the part of Jonah that smart people have a problem with. Verse 17 is the part of the story of Jonah where people say, this can't be real. This must be folklore. This must be the theological term, the hermeneutical term is that this is some midrashic embellishment on the part of the writer in an attempt to make the story more appealing to his reader. He puts a story of a fish who swallows a man in the story to make his book a New York Times bestseller. Yeah, he adds it in. Nothing crazy like this could actually or really happen. And you gotta be honest, I need the folk here who watch CNN and watch National Geographic, and you've seen the Anderson Cooper specials, and you've seen the National Geographic inquiries into the scriptures. They look at texts like this and pick out Jonah chapter 1 and 17 and say, this is why the Bible can't be real. mystical fish that swallow people up in the water. This can't be real. And you know what? You got some pseudo theologians around here now that begin to apologize for Jonah chapter 1:17 because God could not have created a fish to swallow a man. And marine biologists have even gone so far so as to study the genetic makeup of whales and come to a conclusion that a whale could not swallow a man. And I look at them and I say, the Bible didn't say that a whale swallowed a man. I wish I had a witness in here. The Bible tells me that God was at work and that God prepared a great fish. I want you to know, if there's anybody who could prepare a special fish, it was God. Yes, it was God who stepped out on the platform of nothingness and spoke into the darkness of nothingness, and nothing turned into something. If anybody could create a great fish, I want you to know it was God. It was God who took his anvil of his hammer of creativity and wrapped it against the anvil of his omnipotence, and worlds and galaxies unknown came into being. I want you to know, if anybody could make a great fish, it was God. It was the hand of God that anthropomorphically invaded the atmosphere and took the dust of the earth and formed man, and then took a rib from man and made woman. If anybody could make a great fish, I want you to know it was God. It's God who took his hand and scooped out the seas and sat the mountains and put the glaciers into the oceans. It was God who, out of his creative imagination, made rivers and tributaries and lakes that flow thereby. If anybody could create a great fish, it was God. It's God who put the birds to float majestically in the air without ever sending them to flight school and never having a mid-air collision. It was God who put the fish into the sea without ever sending them to swimming lessons at the YMCA. It was God who laid the green carpet on the earth. It was God who put the sun, the fiery king of the day, and the moon, the silvery queen of the night, in her socket. It was God who hanged the stars, the cosmic track lighting, over the heavens. If anybody could create a great fish, it was God. Anybody here can testify God could do it. Just because science can't prove it in a biology lab, just because some marine biologist says that it can't exist, that don't mean that it can't happen. My God can do anything. I wish I had a witness in this house. It was God who created a great fish. And the Bible says that this fish swallowed Jonah. Yes, I would sardonically suggest to you that this fish presents a picture of the mercy of God. And we can see God's mercy in this fish through a number of ways tonight. Look at Jonah drowning in the deep. Look at Jonah plunging to the depths of his death. When they throw Jonah overboard, let's just be honest, somebody could have stood at the edge of the boat and said, "For as much as it hath pleased the Almighty God to take out of this world Brother Jonah, we throw him into this water." Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. Why? Because when they threw Jonah in the water, let's just be honest, Jonah was dead. Yes, he was gone. What do we need of sending any rescuers in the water after him? The tide is pulling Jonah to the depths of his death. say something to you right here as it relates to the mercy of God. Sometimes God's mercy is not in Him removing the consequences for your bad actions from your life. No. Sometimes God's mercy is in allowing you to suffer the consequence and still survive. See, here's the mercy in the text. Jonah should have died in the water. And come on, let's admit to it tonight. God had every reason to let him drown in the water. But the Bible says, through the sovereign provision of God, he prepares a fish that even though Jonah is still in the water, he doesn't die in the water. He's just swallowed up by the fish. Can I tell you what I've discovered about the mercy of God? God's mercy will swallow you up in your trouble. Ooh, I wish I had a witness in here. Yeah, all the cigarettes you have smoked in your life, it should have been you in the ground with lung cancer. But God gives you a little bit of mercy day by day by day so that you survive what other folk have died from. I wish I had a witness in here. That's what our foreparents would cry when they would look unto the Lord and lift their hands and say, Lord, have mercy. Yes. I come to tell you, they knew that some things they just had to bear and deal with. But when they cried for mercy, what they were asking God to do is swallow them up even in their trouble. God, I know I got to go through this, but God, if you would just swallow me up in this thing, I know at least I'll survive it. At least I'll make it. Mercy swallows Jonah. Even though he's supposed to drown in the depths of the water, God spares him by preparing a fish to swallow him up. I wonder if there's anybody here that can thank God for some mercy in your life. I'm talking about you've been guilty of some things just like Jonah in your life, and let's just tell the truth. I mean, God should have killed us for it, but instead of killing us for it, he did what the psalmist said in the 103rd Psalm at the 4th verse. He redeemed your life from destruction. He swallowed you up even in the middle of what you were going through. Because mercy can preserve you even in punishment.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Jonah is now swallowed up in the belly of this great fish. There's another lesson about mercy that we can learn from this fish, and that is mercy is uncomfortable. Mercy is not comfortable. What do you mean mercy is not comfortable? When you press your way further into the book of Jonah, I thank God that Jonah survived this encounter because he tells us what those 3 nights were like in the belly of the fish. Jonah says, when I was in the belly of the fish, I felt like I was in hell. I had seaweeds wrapped around me. Of death, but he testified, when I was in the belly of the whale, it wasn't comfortable for me. God didn't put me in the rich cotton. It wasn't comfortable for me. I didn't feel like I was in the suite, the presidential suite of the Hilton Hotel. It was tight in here, and the only thing I could do when I was in the belly of the fish was one thing. Sisters, God will give you just enough mercy to knock you down to your knees. But God won't deliver you. God won't deliver you and give you scot-free and let you run around here so you can think you got away with what you did, and you can think that you escaped where you came from. But you know what I discovered? God will save you and give you just enough room to lift up your hands and say, Father, I stretch. I wish I had a witness in this house. My hands to thee, no other help I know. If thou withdraw thyself from me, whither shall I go? Because mercy is uncomfortable. For three nights, Jonah is in the belly of the whale, of the fish. For three nights, Jonah has to suffer literally what he calls a living hell. But I thank God tonight for this great fish that God has prepared. Because when we look at this great fish, oh Lord, why I'll stop by to tell somebody that we see the mercy of God. Oh Lord, and I stop by on my way to heaven tonight to tell somebody that if we can really learn how to pray right, oh Lord, why if we can learn how to truly call on the name of God, if we can truly learn how to approach His throne, oh Lord, why we'll stop asking God for material possessions. Oh Lord, why we will stop asking God for a fine car and for a large home. Oh Lord, why but when we learn how to call on the name of God, we'll do just like Jonah. And even when we're in the belly of the fish, oh Lord, we'll lift our hands and look to heaven and say, Lord, have mercy. Oh Lord, I just want to know tonight, because He showed me that even when I'm down and out, and even when I messed up and I failed the Lord, if I make my way down to my knees, God will hear and answer prayer. Just nudge your neighbor and say, neighbor, I serve the prayer answering God. Is there anybody here that can testify that just like God sent a fish for Jonah, just like God rescued a Jonah from the water, I was sinking deep in sin. God bless your heart tonight. Far from the peaceful shore, very deeply staying within, I was sinking. Anybody here was sinking to ride or no more? But this is the part of the hymn I like. But the master of the sea, he lifted me
Sit there and look like a bumper
doing it alone. But if God has been good to you, I dare you to go wrap your arms around your neighbor and say, neighbor, you don't know like I know what the you just don't care if the Lord has made a way for you. Do me one more favor. Get out of your road. Go thank somebody. Wrap your arms around your neighbor. Say, neighbor, he's been God. Yes, he has. He's been God. Has the Lord been good to you? Has the Lord been good to you? Anybody here tonight? The Lord has saved your soul. Anybody here tonight? The Lord has picked you up. The Lord has turned you around. Say yeah. So much. I see somebody sitting there saying, it doesn't take all of that to praise the Lord. But can I tell you, I praise the Lord because he's been good to me. Can I tell you five reasons why I holler so much? Reason one, the Lord has been good to me. Anybody here can testify. Reason number two, the Lord has so been good to me. Reason number three, why I holler so much. The Lord sure has been good to me. Reason four, why I holler. The Lord sure been good to me. Reason five. Can anybody guess what reason five is? The Lord. The Lord. Do I have any old saints here that know how to turn the prayer wheel? That can just say, yeah, yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah, oh, oh yeah. Anybody here pray for the night, for the Lord in your life? Anybody here can testify, if it had not been, I'm sorry, I'm just in last night in revival mode. I see some of y'all ain't come to praise him. That's fine. You can feel free to be seated. But is there anybody here? You know that God has been good to you. Won't he pick you up? Anybody here can testify. He'll pick you up. He'll pick you up. He'll pick you up. Turn you around. Place your feet on solid ground. Want to give you joy. Can you shout, 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 shout,
Ghost. Anybody can testify, it's just like fire.
Shut up it.
If the Lord don't help me, I wish I had a witness in here. I can't stand the storm. Just look at somebody and tell them, if the Lord don't help me,
yeah. I used to have an old deacon in my church. He would sit in the corner of the church, and every now and then he would bow down on his knees and he'd say, if you be me, tell him I'm on my way. If you be me, yeah, yeah, tell them I want my way, yeah. Anybody here got joy tonight? Anybody here got joy tonight? Anybody here got joy tonight? You got joy. Can you just help me say this? This joy that I had, oh, the world didn't give it to me. Oh, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me. Say it like you got joy tonight.
When I first came here, there was
an older lady that I met, and she took me in. And then I came back a few times, and she took my wife and my children in as well. Now, on an individual basis, a lot of people can take you in and they can reject you. They don't have to take you in. And then when she took my children and my wife in, it done something different, and it meant something different to me. Because some people don't have to accept you or anything that comes with you. And for quite some time now, I have been graced with her presence. She is more closer to 100 than what I am to 35. I look at her, and last year when we bought this edifice, we had church dedication, and it was storming raining. And she beat me here. And it wasn't just no little rain, it was coming down pretty hard. One night our lights went out, but she still made it. Amen. Amen. And I want to ask that the mother of our church, Mrs. Emma Williams, will stand right now. We have something for you from the pastor and my wife, and also from the New Fellowship Baptist Church. We want to give something to you because we want to appreciate you while you can hear and see us, rather when God called you from labor to reward. Amen. Let's stand. Is one of the oldest matriarchs in the state of Louisiana. Amen. Not just in the parish, but in the state. Mommy, we want to see.
I'm 97 years old. And I've been had a hard time making this money, but I made it.
Amen.
And I just ask y'all to keep me in your prayers.
Amen.
I don't know what the Lord holds for me, but I'm ready for whatever He wants. And when I go, I thank God for one. Heaven will be my home.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. She's one of the oldest, not only in the parish, but also in this state of Louisiana. We thank you for what our eyes have heard and what our ears have heard and what our eyes have seen. Amen? Amen. Lighthouse and announcements.
Now, we're just grateful to be here. Amen. Thank God for the message that we received tonight.
Amen.
God, young man, give him a hand. Amen.
Amen.
Amen, amen. Reverend Rice is my father in the gospel. He has played an intricate part in me. Amen. Amen. It's yes, sir, to Perry Rice, all in my house, everywhere I go. Amen. Amen. And all of the, my mother is here tonight. I'm grateful for her presence. For all of y'all that have come, we thank you for what we have been able to do this week. Those of you all that want copies of DVDs and CDs, you can see me after service. Amen.
I just want to say thank you once again to Pastor Trust Claire for the invitation to share with you guys on this week. And
I am cognizant of the fact that there are many preachers in this area who are far more gifted and able than me, that this preacher could have called to share with you this week. I'm just grateful that he called me, and I pray that you've been blessed on this week. I'm cognizant of the fact that the Holy Spirit does the reviving. The preacher is only a vessel. So it is my prayer that on this week, whatever purpose the Lord had for this church for this week has been accomplished. I don't believe in just having revival to have revivals. I just believe that when we come together for revival, the Holy Spirit has a purpose. God has a purpose for his people, and we pray that that purpose has been achieved through us. I want to thank you for the way that you have received those who have come with me. I don't think that I am anything more than anybody else. I've learned going into this is my 12th year preaching. I started preaching when I was 18 years old. I'm going into my 6th year pastoring. At the end of August, I celebrated 6 years as the pastor of the First African Church in New Orleans, church that my grandfather pastored for 52 years, and my father pastored for 7 years. So I realized that everything I have, I stand on the shoulders of someone who came before me. So I never lose sight of that, and I never lose sight of the fact that people do not have to be nice. Brother Terrell Jones, I told you my Baker crew, they live up here. He's been with me every night. My uncle Roderick Gordon, the cool Gordon, amen. Moses Gordon II is the singing / preaching Gordon. Chris Gordon, Crispus Gordon Jr. is President Gordon. That's cool, Brother Gordon, right there. Amen. Uncle Roderick and I, we roll together, and I'm grateful for the way that you have received him. And not only that, my father can just sing and sing and sing and sing. I mean, and then after he finishes singing, he can preach and preach and preach and preach. And then once he finishes dissecting a text, he can hoop and hoop and hoop and hoop. And for the time 12 years that I've been preaching, some people call me just to see if I can do what my daddy does. And I tell people, I can't do that, man. My daddy, he is just one of a kind. I don't have that much air capacity in my lungs to holler like my daddy can holler. So I need a musician to pitch me. So I thank God for Brother Kevin, who's come every night. And I thank God for the way that you received him. He shared with me that some of you have purchased his project. We are coming to the Baton Rouge area. Amen. And he'll share with you. You'll see his name. Amen. But if you have not purchased his project, and it's not him singing on the album, one of Baton Rouge's own, Tamisha Eagleheart, my friend, the daughter of Dr. Rayford Eagleheart, she's singing on the project. That's the hometown crew for Baton Rouge. Amen. Pastor Jai Reed, he's been on Bobby Jones Gospel. Amen. He's singing on the project. My father is singing on the project. My sister and a couple of others are singing on the project. So I know you see Kay Lampton Entertainment. He can't sing. Amen. But he's smart enough to surround himself with people who can sing. I tell people, I tell you, know your gift and stay in your lane. Amen. And I want y'all to know something. For those of you who purchased that project, and I'm not trying to persuade you or push you, I'm saying this because I'm proud.